Welcome back. It's still The Breakfast on PLUS TV Africa, away from the Ikoyi Registry and, of course, on marriage licenses. We'll be looking at national revenue and public finance, and specifically the Debt Management Office has put Nigeria's public debt at 38.005 trillion naira by the third quarter of 2021. That's between July 1st and September 30, 2021. Are we okay? Are we afloat? Are we in troubled waters? These are some of the issues where we just need to find out and get solutions and clarifications on. Joining us this time around is Mukhtar Mohammed. He is a financial analyst. Good morning to you, Mukhtar. Thanks for joining us on this particular discourse.
Thank you. Good morning.
All right. A lot of Nigerians, are seemingly worried that for us to have hit that particular amount in 9 months, 0.005 trillion naira. Is it something good, or is it that we should be worried? Are we okay as a nation in terms of our finances?
Well, okay as a nation in terms of our finances. I don't think we're okay as a nation in terms of our finances. That's why we are borrowing. We are okay to borrow. I need to get it clear here that borrowing in itself is not a bad idea. But again, it's meeting your payment plan and then what is behind the borrowing. Like the House of Assembly was telling them that they need to know what are the conditions of the borrowing. So that is also very, very important. Borrowing itself is not bad. And if you look at this particular borrowing that they've been doing, that is tied to specific projects. The World Bank project is there for agriculture. You look at power project from the Chinese Emsen Bank. You look, all the projects are tied to specific, which makes it nice. So definitely this project that can have what we call a snowball effect that will be able to also impact other area and also be able to create jobs, especially for the middle class and the downtrodden, especially when it comes to construction of all these projects, infrastructural development. So the only challenge we have as a nation that we've been grappling with is not because our debt to GDP that the government always reminds us about. It's our debt to revenue that is a challenge. So if you look at our debt to revenue, then we have every cause to be worried. We look at our debt to the GDP, we don't have so much cause to worry because we are still under a good threshold. But when you look at the debt to revenue, then we have every cause to be worried. That means we are definitely taking more than we can chew.
Okay, let's also look at the fact that, looking at this administration in 2015, Niger's debt profile increased under President Muhammadu Buhari from 12 trillion naira to this point that we're 38 trillion. How did we get to this point? What are we doing? What are we doing wrongly? And how can we correct all of this?
I think the Buhari administration comes with a lot of promises, and they are trying to meet up these promises, especially in the area of infrastructure. I think they are trying to set a legacy for themselves, the area of building of infrastructure. And they don't care how they are going to do that if it means borrowing. I think that's what they are basically doing. Because when you look at the type of borrowing they have been borrowing ever since they came in, it's tied to specific projects which we can do and we can see if this borrowing, you look at the rail project, you look at the road project, you look at the power project, even if we have not seen so much impact yet. But we must know that most of all these projects are long-term projects. They are not projects that you just begin to find impact anytime soon. So if you look at that, you said, okay, fine. The borrowing itself is not bad. But you say from 12 trillion, like you say, when they came into 38 trillion, which is almost double what over what we had before. Then you need to look at when they came in, what was the price of crude, what was our revenue base. Since they came in, revenue base have been dwindling. So if they have to go by that, they might just end up in salaries alone and they will not be able to do any project. So I think they looked at the other way around, is to borrow and to borrow to tie to Pacific. And because some of these projects have their own effect on the economy, which in turn can generate the payment of some of these loans. And we will not forget the fact that sometimes they are borrowing also to also build our external reserve, like the 4 billion euro bond borrowing that they just did. It was to us building our reserve to see how we can control the volatility in our exchange rate. even if we have not achieved that yet. We just added 4 billion to our external reserve. So those are part of the strategies that they are using to combat external reserve, also volatility exchange rate, and also is trying to look at means to build infrastructure instead of just paying salaries alone and not be able to do anything. I think for me, it's a good strategy, but I just feel that sometimes there are other type of borrowing that we should have been doing, like what we call infrastructural borrowing, using your project as a tool to gain investors to come and invest in that project, and then you in turn gain revenue from those projects when the investors are invested. But we've not been able to use that yet, and I don't know why the government is not using that.
All right, Mokhtar, interestingly, you said that we should be worried because we have a problem when it comes to debt to revenue, you know, ratio. But it's coming in the wake of the House of Representatives approving a loan request of $5.8 billion and a grant of $10 million as requested by the president. So what is the issue right now? Is it that we are having some sort of funding mismatch? We are not actually putting these funds, you know, to where they should go and bring the revenues that we need? Because out of all of this, the House of Reps, the lawmakers are also asking for transparency, you know, regarding the terms and conditions given by the funding agencies.
That is the challenge. That is the challenge, because I don't know why the House be asking for terms and references. Those are things that are supposed to come with the approval. You don't just approve without looking at the terms and references, and they will not approve, and then you don't be asking for the terms and references. That's not the way it is done. You can't be approving then you're asking for terms and references after you finish approving. You need to look at the terms and references before you approve to see whether these debts are viable or they are obtainable or will be able to pay. So for me, the House of Rep or the Senate has become a rubber stamp to whatever the president did, especially in the area of borrowing. It just seems that they just stamp it, and then after telling them to go and tell us what do you really want to do with the money after the money has been approved. So for me, that is a major challenge. Like I said, they have what we call public-private partnership. That's what the world is turning into. Instead of government bringing in all the funds, government is using their project as part of their own tool to say, okay, this is what we have, this is the project. You take it, you build and manage it for the next 25 years, for the next 30 years. After that, you hand it over for us. You bear all the costs. Those are what is done. Then with that, you are able to channel some of this money that you used to servicing this debt into other key areas that will bring up policy that will attract investors, that will create jobs for you. But you see, in Nigeria, governance has gone to where they look at the cheapest way out of every situation. And the cheapest way the government will think is out of every situation is just to go and borrow. So that is what they are doing. They are not thinking out of the box. They are looking for a cheap means, and they think borrowing is it. They don't care how, because they will tell you that some of this borrowing, we are getting it at a very ridiculous interest rate, which is less than what you get from the commercial bank, which is true. But then again, you need to look at it. You are mortgaging the future of a generation that is might not yet born. They will be the one to pay some of these debts.
Okay, you have mentioned the fact that revenue shortfall is a major concern for us. And of course, at the time, we actually experienced 33.3% that shortfall. Now, what do we... We also experience the fact that we've had, a fair rise in the prices of crude oil. Why has that not really improved on, the fiscal situation of the country?
When you talk about crude oil, why has it not improved the fiscal situation? And like I said, we make the revenue in one area, then in the other area we spend it. You look at, we just make revenue in terms of crude oil, what a refined petroleum product. So what we do is that what we source according in terms of revenue, we spend it in the other way, payment or subsidy. So at the end of the day, the money is not coming to the Federation account, and that will help states and local governments. So that is the major challenge. As long as we keep on paying subsidy, and some of the subsidies are paid through the earnings that we earn through crude, because we are not refining enough for local consumption. So that is basically the challenge, why you are not seeing those impact of the crude oil price on our external reserve. Because what we do is that we sell the crude and we import refined petroleum product. And the cost of refining importing refined petroleum product is getting higher by the day. Because when you look at, and NNPC was telling us that we use about 1.something trillion fuel daily million, at least 1.5 million liters of water daily. I think more than that even. So, and then you look at the subsidy payment that they said at the end of this year, we could be paying subsidy of about 1.5 trillion. So you see that it's not commensurable what we earn in crude oil. So the challenge is that we make so much money from crude oil, but we end up paying using it to deal with our challenges that has to do with refining this product back to Nigeria.
So, okay, just quickly, let me chip this in now. With 33 trillion naira as our debt profile now, what are the concerns? What does this mean for investors, both foreign and local investors?
For local investors, it could mean, local investors are looking at it in terms of how does it impact in macroeconomy, activities, and for that is not helping local investors, because what means is that local investors are going to be paying more for a lot of activities, then that means the bottom line in terms of your profit margin becomes low because the cost of doing business will be high. So that is what it means for local investors. But for foreign investors, they see as a gold mine, because in their own economy, they don't get that return. You're talking about the Eurobond. The Eurobond will give a return of 7.5% for every investor that invests in the Eurobond, which they cannot get it. So what we're seeing that for foreign investors, it seems to be attractive to them because of the return. But for local investors, even if you decide to invest in the Eurobond, it will not be an attractive return for you because you are doing inflation. Inflation almost 15%, and then you are getting 7.5%. But for those foreign investors that are patronizing the Eurobond, their inflation, if not for United States, they have an inflation of 6.8%. So even with the inflation of 6.8%, you still have 7.5%. So it's attractive to the foreign investor, but to Nigerian investors, it doesn't look attractive. So it's a disadvantage towards Nigerian investors, but very, very advantageous to foreign investors.
Okay, as we round off now, Mukhtar, let's look at other ways the federal government can actually generate revenue in terms of IGR. You know, in as much as the finance minister Zainab Ahmed has said that in 2020 there may be some revisiting of some, policies, the tax policies in terms of the finance bill. She talked about, the stamp duties. She also talked about the capital gains, tax. You know, should we be looking in that direction? Is it the right step in the right direction, really?
Fortunately, not the right step in the right direction, because you are trying to, you are saying you want to attract investors into your economy. Look, tax has gone beyond using tax as a means of revenue. Use tax as a means of growing your economy. Attract the right investor, create the jobs. When you create the job, those people that are working in the job will pay tax. So there's a snowball effect. But when you think of always taxing, the only way you think you can get revenue is to put more tax on your people. Now you're trying to attract investors to your economy. Your currency is suffering in a lot of ways, and you are trying to attract foreign investors so that it could stabilize your currency. And now what you're thinking of, that for every capital gain, there must be a tax. Now, remember that Nigeria has always attracted foreign portfolio investors, and those foreign portfolio investors are the ones that in turn will become foreign direct investors. By the time you begin to tax capital gain on each of those foreign investors, you will not attract them any longer, and that will make your currency continue to suffer the way. So government should begin to look at itself as a way to attract the right investors into your economy, instead of just seeing tax as a means of just getting revenue. You're talking about the government within locally want to widen the tax bracket. We're saying, well, what did you give to widen the tax bracket? What are you giving to the informal sector that will attract them, that will make them want to pay tax, because they know they are enjoying a certain percentage of benefit from government that is helping their business, but whereby informal sector are still the one helping for themselves, providing power, providing infrastructure for themselves to build their business, and you are thinking of widening the gap. It's a challenge. So what the government should begin to look is, how can we use tax as a tool to build, to grow our economy, and in turn be able to tax the people that are going to be benefiting from the growth of the economy. That is the way developed economy works these days. That's why you have tax bracket for some businesses and also many other policies. But unfortunately, Nigerian government only just think of revenue.
All right, we must say a very big thank you to you, Mukhtar Mohammed, and financial analyst, for bringing some insight into all of the public debts and the ways forward. We do appreciate your time.
Thank you.
All right, that's the size of the show for today. Once again, a very big thank you to all of you who have sat back to watch. We return again 7 a.m. tomorrow. My name is Justin Akadowonye.
And I am Mercy Bopo. If you missed out on any part of the conversation, that's all right. To follow us on Facebook and Instagram, as at Plus TV Africa. And on YouTube, as at Plus TV Africa Lifestyle. Do have a great day.